Hi, my name is Daniel Rijsbergen and I'm a postdoctoral researcher at the Singapore University of Technology and Design. And today I will present LAXA, a probabilistic proof-of-stake protocol. This is joint work with my colleagues Pavel Salikowski, Jimin Kay, Xingpeng Li and Jianying Zhou. LAXA is inspired by Bitcoin, the world's first practical cryptocurrency. Cryptocurrencies allow users to hold digital coins and send them to other users. To send digital coins, a user would create a transaction on a so-called distributed ledger. This ledger is maintained by a peer-to-peer network. So it does not require that a trusted third party, such as a bank, decides on transactions. Instead, the peers in the network use the Nakamoto Consensus Protocol to agree which new transactions are added to the ledger. In Nakamoto Consensus, some peers expend computational power to solve cryptographic puzzles. And when they find a solution to such a puzzle, then they can add a batch of new transactions to the ledger. This process is called proof of work, and the nodes that perform it are called miners. And if a miner finds a solution, then they earn a reward in the form of coins on the ledger. Nakamoto Consensus can support many more active nodes than earlier consensus protocols, because it does not require a lot of communication between the nodes. However, Nakamoto Consensus also has several drawbacks. The first is that the energy cost of proof of work is very high. In fact, the Bitcoin network as a whole consumes as much electricity as a medium-sized country. The second drawback is a slow and insecure transaction commitment process. And by commitment process, we mean that a node can decide for a transaction that it's highly unlikely that it will be overturned by another transaction. Bitcoin has a rule of thumb for this called the six confirmations rule, but this is quite slow. It will take on average over an hour. Furthermore, it's insecure because during network partitions, it doesn't have strong security guarantees. Finally, Nakamoto Consensus only very infrequently rewards peers. Only when they find a solution to a puzzle do they get a reward. Because it is quite unlikely, small players are not incentivized to participate. To address the high energy use in Nakamoto Consensus, so-called proof-of-stake protocols have been proposed. In proof-of-stake, nodes do not need computational power to add transactions to the ledger, but they can instead lock coins on the ledger to win the right to add transactions. This avoids the high energy use of Nakamoto Consensus, but still, the other drawbacks from Nakamoto Consensus might be copied. Instead, we propose LAXA, Large-Scale Non-Committee Stake-Based Agreement. This is a proof-of-stake protocol that's dedicated, but not restricted to cryptocurrencies. LAXA supports large numbers of peers, similar to Nakamoto Consensus. We sample committees from the full set of peers to vote on new transactions. This enables fast consensus using hypothesis testing. We also reward the nodes for the votes they cast as committee members. This gives a high reward frequency and therefore encourages participation. The core design choices of LAXA are as follows. As in Bitcoin, transactions are grouped into blocks, and each block references a previous block, forming a chain. In each round, so LAXA progresses as a sequence of rounds, such as each round has a fixed time duration. In each round, nodes are pseudo-randomly selected to propose a block or to vote for an existing block. This is done over two phases. So in the first phase, those nodes that have been selected to vote for an existing block. And during the second phase, the block proposers collect these votes, add new transactions, create a block and broadcast it to the network. The leaders and voters are selected through a procedure called cryptographic sortition. Here we assume that there are so-called stake units, which are the set of coins that are involved in consensus. For example, those coins locked on the blockchain. In a cryptographic sortition, a random beacon is used to shuffle the full set of stake units. And peers are assigned to roles, such as block proposer or committee member, based on the ordering of the stake units. As an example, in round i-1, the owner of the eighth stake unit is selected as the leader or block proposer. And the owners of the 4th, 7th, and 10th stake unit are selected as voters. We note that if a node controls multiple stake units, then they can be selected for more than one role in a single round. LAXA is designed to tolerate network partitions. So during a network partition, some nodes in the peer-to-peer network are not able to communicate with all other nodes. Such partitions might emerge naturally. For example, in the internet, this happens from time to time, but it can also be caused by a network-level attack, in which case it might last for several hours. We know from the CAP theorem that during a network partition, the consensus protocol can choose either safety or liveness. Safety means that all peers agree on which blocks are committed, whereas liveness means that eventually new blocks are committed. So during a partition, either one of the partitions stops committing new blocks, which would violate liveness, or all partitions keep committing blocks, but then because they cannot agree, because they cannot communicate, this would violate safety. During a network partition, a fork might emerge in the blockchain. So a fork occurs when two blocks exist, such that neither is a predecessor of the other. So for example, in the example on the slide, we see that after the second block, a partition emerges, after which two branches are created on the blockchain. The blue branch on top and the green branch on the bottom. So here blocks are indicated by squares with a solid exterior. And when on one branch a block is not proposed in a given round, then this is indicated using the dashed lines. Eventually the partition will be resolved. And at this point, the blocks become aware of both branches of the fork, and they need to decide which of these two branches is the main branch. In Nakamoto consensus, nodes simply choose the branch with the largest number of blocks. However, in Luxa, we use the most stake rule, which means that we choose the branch which has the highest number of stake units supporting it. So in the example on the slide, nodes would prefer the blue branch because it has more stake units supporting it due to the larger number of votes cast to support it. So green blocks that become aware of the blue, green nodes that become aware of the blue branch would need to revert the green blocks. This by itself does not cause a safety fault unless they have committed those green blocks. So we must come up with a secure block commitment rule to avoid this kind of safety faults. So this is made complicated by adversarial peers. Adversarial peers try to cause faults. They try to cause safety faults, which means that two honest peers commit conflicting blocks. Or they try to cause safety liveness faults, which means that no new honest blocks are ever committed. So we require two fundamental properties then. The first is probabilistic safety, which means that the probability of a safety fault is below some threshold set by the user, even during a partition. The second property is liveness, which means that after the partition is resolved, an honest block will eventually be committed. In our model, we assume that nodes can be Byzantine, which means that they can send different messages to different users. And we assume partial synchrony, which means that there's a upper bound on the communication delays. Furthermore, we assume that nodes stay on the same branch during a partition, because otherwise they might become aware of adversarial behavior. So the adversarial peers can equivocate. Equivocation means that they either vote or propose conflicting, they either produce conflicting votes or blocks and send them to different nodes in the peer-to-peer network. So this makes it harder for peers to decide whether they are on the branch that has the largest number of stake units supporting it. If they are on such a strongest partition, then it's safe for them to commit. However, it's impossible for them to know whether they are on the biggest branch. They can only try to guess from the number of blocks and votes that they see whether they are on the strongest branch. But of course, equivocation makes it harder to determine. So as an example, in the example on the slide, the red circles indicate adversarial votes. So we see that although only 9 committee members are chosen in each round, the total number of votes cast across the two branches is higher because the adversarial nodes vote on both branches simultaneously. This makes it harder for nodes to observe if they are on the majority branch. However, if we assume that at most one third of the peers are adversarial, then it's sufficient for nodes if they see that on average two thirds of the stake units support their branch. So to commit, they need to decide if they are on the branch with more than two thirds support. So is it enough to look at a single block? For large committees, yes, because the probability of seeing very strong support in a single block can be quite low for large committees. However, we want small committees for efficiency purposes. So now the key insight is that even though it might be still relatively likely to see strong support in one block, to see it consistently over several blocks in a row, this probability decreases exponentially. This means that we can commit quite fast. So in the graph on the right, we have depicted for a given average number of fractional support for a branch, how quickly the probability of safety fault decreases if the number of rounds increases. So in this graph, we have 150 committee members per round. And if only 75% on average support their branch, then even after only 15 rounds, we can conclude that the probability of a safety fault is below 10 to the power minus 16, which is quite low. We then use hypothesis testing to determine when the probability has become low enough to commit a block. So here we look at the average support between a new block and the last committed block. We look at the average support over all these rounds. And if the probability of seeing this much support over so many rounds is low enough, then we commit. So in the paper, we compare to a closely related protocol, which is called Algorand. And Algorand uses verifiable random functions to select leaders and nodes. In verifiable random functions, nodes mix a private key and their stake with a random beacon to generate a pseudo-random value y. The node is then selected as a leader or voter based on the value of y. The main consequences of this are that it's impossible for nodes to determine which other nodes have been selected as committee members or leaders. And the second consequence is that the size of the committee is no longer fixed. For block commitment, Algorand looks at one block at a time, but they make some additional assumptions, such that the committee is quite large and that the adversarial strength is limited, so only 20%. So fixed committee sizes allow us to commit faster using hypothesis testing. With fixed committees, we have less variance in the amount of stake that we observe per round. And this makes it easier to determine if we are on the majority branch. So as we can see in the slide, fixed committees allow us to commit with only one third of the number of rounds that we would need if we use VRFs. So this makes it quite faster. So we have seen that we can commit rapidly and with small committees. So does that mean there's something as free lunch? Unfortunately, no. Luxa has a vulnerability to adaptive attackers that, for example, Algorand does not. Because the cryptographic sortition reveals to all nodes in the network which nodes have been selected as leaders or committee members, attackers can try to attack those the leaders or committee members, for example, using denial of service. However, such attacks can be mitigated using network-level anonymity protocols, for example, Dandelion, or the protocol implemented in Tendermint. Alternatively, we can select block proposers and committee members using VRFs, as in Algorand. And as we just saw, this would reduce the commitment speed, but we can still use our hypothesis testing procedure. So to conclude, Luxa enables fast block commitment, even for large networks, by sampling small committees and making commitment decisions based on hypothesis testing. The hypothesis testing procedure can be applied more generally, for example, in combination with VRFs, as in Algorand. However, this makes it a bit more slow. But also in the paper, we discuss integration with Ghost, liveness proofs, the proof of fairness, a discussion of a reward scheme, and a practical implementation. But due to time restrictions, I have not discussed those yet. However, an interesting research problem is if we can select fixed-size committees without revealing the identities of the nodes. This can be done using a multi-party computation, but the question is whether this can be done efficiently. And this is an open research problem. So thank you for your attention. If you have any questions, feel free to email us or ask questions in the Slack channel on the provided by the conference. Thank you.